Welcome to Daily Boost. This is yours truly, Dr. Charles Ndifon, and I am excited you've come to join me today. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We have an exciting program today, and I hope I'll take a moment and just join everybody that's coming joining in right now. I know Tina from Berlin. I'm going to be in Germany very soon, and that will be on the 1st. I'll be in Hamburg, Germany, and then from the 5th to the 7th, I'll be in Lüdenscheid in Germany. And also, I want to invite you to come to the Power School of Miracles, and this is going to be a great finish to the week. It's going to be amazing. What God has for you, no one can take it away from you. Whatever thing has been blocking you, be removed today as revelation comes to you. The Bible says grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of Him. The Bible says His divine power has given us all things that pertain unto life and to godliness. I see Lewis. Great program last night, Lewis. That was beautiful. I love the setup that you have. And we have Pastor Brian. We have Adik, God bless you. Shanna, we have Tanya and Odette, and then we have, I want to make sure I can, we have Donna, we have Lisa. Thank you all for joining me. I needed to take a little break in the last couple of days. I've been working very diligently, doing a lot of work here just to make sure we can bring some amazing programs to you in the near future. So it requires a lot of work. Share this with others. I'm going to get started today. It's going to be a great day, and I know this is Wednesday. This is Daily Boost, and I want to be sharing with you, same continuing, we have to finish up, the 21 reasons for boldness, why you operate by different rules. The Bible says, for the law of the Spirit of life that is in Christ Jesus has made you free from the law of sin and death. Bonjour, bonjour. That's wonderful. So the law of the Spirit of life that is in Christ Jesus has made us free from the law of sin and death. Yesterday, I was out and about taking care of some business, and as I decided to listen to a Christian program on the radio, and I started listening to it, and a minute into it, I heard the Holy Spirit say, don't turn it off, listen. And I kept listening, and I kept listening, and it troubled my spirit. It troubled my spirit, because what they were talking about was not the present truth. Basically, what they were talking about, saying that basically that in this state, they're trying to make it like it was normal to be sick, that when we get to heaven, everything is going to be all right. That means it almost seems like or sounds like Jesus died so that when you get to heaven, everything is fine. Now, I beg to differ. Jesus died so that things will be well with you now. Now, that does not mean you won't have some challenges, but you are fully equipped by the Word of God and with the Word of God to deal with the situations you meet in life just as He did. We have to understand that. If we don't understand that, then something is missing in the whole equation. We have to come to the place where we are fully aware of this truth, that every situation and every circumstances that happen here, the Bible says He has given us all things that pertain to life and to godliness or godlikeness. He has given us all things that pertain to life, to live the life of God on this earth. The Bible says in Romans, it talked about we shall reign in life. So I choose to operate by different rules. I choose to operate by different rules. It is important we understand that the believers are operating by a higher wisdom. We are operating by the higher wisdom. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 2, it says, for the law of the Spirit of life that is in Christ Jesus has made us free or has made you free from the law of sin and death. And that is talking about that right now. Right now, when you believe this good news, it translates into power for you, power for your miracles, power to change you and to bring you to a place of uncommon results. And so that's what we believe, and that's what God does. You see, you only live by the revelation you have. You live by the revelation you have. You cannot live beyond the revelation you have. So they are people. I'm not being critical of what I heard, but I'm just bringing a correction, because if you tell something that's not true, if you tell a lie long enough, people will think it's the truth. If it's never challenged, everyone would accept it as the truth. But we need to know what the Word of God says so that we can take God at His Word, face value, and we can produce the God results. So I hope you, if you understand that, I want your thumbs up. I want your participation today. Okay? So I take time to come to you every day, whenever time permits, to bring something that we need to know what the Word of God says. I want to encourage you that you have within you the Word of God that you are taking in. It will deal with any situation you face. It will deal with any situation. You have wisdom to solve your problems. You have hope that comes from the Word. You have faith and love that comes from the Word. So we need to pay attention to what the Word of God is saying and not what religious people will tell us. We are supernatural beings. We have to remember that. We are supernatural people, and we have to operate as such, because I realize this. Not a lot of time you go to places, you hear people actually tell you what the Bible says. They have a lot of opinions. And they use other people as a means to back up their lack of believing the Word of God. For example, there is a precious lady that had an accident when she was younger, and she had an accident and became paralyzed. And I listened to this people that were talking about during the broadcast, actually talking about that because of that accident, the young lady drew close to God. We don't draw close to God because we are in trouble. We draw close to God because we love Him. So we have to understand that very clearly. A lot of times I've heard some people say things. I see Lori's on, and I see Prophet Frank Udo. I'll see you all at a power school July the 16th to the 22nd. You can't miss it. We have a great lineup of amazing anointed men and women of God that are coming up. So you need to be there. It's going to be glorious. Hallelujah. Now, I've heard some people try to say some things that's not based on the Word of God. You never change the Word of God to fit your experiences. You never do that. You always use the truth from God's Word to change your experiences so that your experiences will be the Word of God experience. You overcome by the word of your testimony. You overcome by the blood of the Lamb. You overcome. The Bible declares that we are overcomers. 1 John chapter 4 verse 4 and 1 John chapter 5 verse 4. It tells you whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, your faith. You overcome the world now, not when you're dead. So we need to get that very clear. Hello, Pastor Laddie. Hallelujah. And I see Pastor Laurie. God bless you. Now, the reason I'm saying this is because we live in a society where a lot of times people will say a lot of things that is not based on truth. If a lie, I see my wonderful brother Andreas, all the way from Germany. I'm coming to Germany. I'm going to be there next weekend. I'm going to be there. Hopefully we can connect and meet and see. I miss you, man of God. I can't wait to see you face to face. Now, I was saying this. It is important that you don't lose sight of the Word of God. The problem is when we hear people try to use their negative experiences to make the word of God of no effect or to try to tell them. I call that traditions. It's traditions that make the word of no effect. So they will tell you the reason why miracles are not happening is because so-and-so, whoever famous person, you know, prayed and no miracles happened. But that does not change the truth of God's word. Because they prayed and nothing happened does not mean that the word of God does not work. It works. So in other words, the broadcast yesterday on this national radio station in the United States was to the point of telling you that when we get to heaven right now, when we get to heaven, we will have a perfect everything. But right now we are in the fallen state. And then my question is, what does the scripture mean then when it tells you to glorify God in your body? To glorify, if healing was for the future, then what does it mean to glorify God in your body? It's not just talking about you not sinning. See, you don't glorify God in your spirit by sinning. Why would you glorify God in your body by allowing sickness to come on you? Think about that. I see our international director, Princess Rieke and Maria. So now I'm saying this because a lot of times people say, well, you know, the sickness, you know, they try to explain that out. You have to understand this. It is important you don't explain out. You need to take God's word face value. You need to take it. Because I hear, you know, the gentleman was saying, he was basically stating that we will have a perfect healing later on. And that, you know, right now our bodies are not perfect. And when we get to heaven, it will be perfect. And we will have no sickness. God is going to heal us. We're going to be walking around, you know, perfectly healed. Now, the thing is, the reason why I don't believe in that at all is, number one, whatever Jesus paid, he paid for it for you to receive the benefit right now. He paid for your sins so that you can be forgiven now. He paid for your sicknesses so that you can be healed now. He became poor so that you can be rich now. See, he paid those things. His heart was broken so that yours can be healed now. That's the important thing we have to understand. We need to challenge any statement, any voice that will speak contrary to the word of God, regardless of how famous they are. We need to take a stand for the word of God, and God is well able to do what he has said. 2 Kings 8, verse 56, the Bible says, "They has not failed one word of all of his great promises, which he promised to his servant." He promised to his servant, Moses. But you can say that today, God's word never fails. The Bible declares that all of his promises are really yes. That means he says yes to those promises, and in him they are amen. So it's important we have to understand it is only good news if it is good for now. It is only good news if it is good for now. So why would you settle for a lesser life when there is a greater life already available in you? See, what you listen to determines what shapes how you believe. So if you're listening to people that are negative, you are going to sound negative. I see Apostle Aid is on. Hallelujah. Now, hear this. All that God has said. So like I said, I was listening to this program. The Holy Spirit told me, listen to it. And I was listening, and I could see how this gentleman was trying to justify the reason why we don't get healed now, but we get healed later. And the Holy Spirit said, the reason I asked you to listen to it is to see where error is introduced into the life of God, where the enemy has a foothold, where something negative begins to happen to those that are supposed to have received the life of God. I hope you understand what I'm talking about today. So I'm talking about you can operate by different rules. The Bible declares, it says, you are of God. You are of God, little children, and you have overcome the world. You have overcome the world. It does not say you will overcome the world. You have overcome by the word that you declare, by what you believe, by what you focus on, meditate upon. You begin to change the situations and the circumstances of your life. The Bible says in Joshua chapter 1 verse 8, it said, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. This book shall not depart from your mouth. In other words, it says, don't speak it, but first meditate. Don't speak the word of God until you are convinced and believe what you're about to say. Because once you say it, it becomes the law. Once it leaves your mouth, the Bible says you shall give account of whatever you've said. So whatever you say is what you're going to get. What you say is an indication of what you believe. You can't just confess positive, but the picture on the inside is a negative picture. You've got to see yourself the way God sees you. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. So when I heard that yesterday, I was kind of a little troubled. And I said, I should address that today, because we live in a world where things like those things go unchallenged. Hallelujah. We are of God, little children. You have overcome. Overcome. You have. Now, the Bible does not say you will overcome. It says you have overcome the world. You have overcome the world. Why? Because greater is He that is in you. Reasons why you operate by different rules is because the greater one lives in you. Reason number 15. The greater one dwells in you. That's why you play by different rules. Because I know the greater one dwells in me, my take on life will become an expression of that which has possessed me. That which has possessed me, I now go and I become the physical expression of God. God is my spirit. I am His flesh. He gives me His spirit. I give Him my flesh. Put that together. That's what you call a believer. You are a believer, a believing person. A believing person is an extraordinary person. He's not religious. He's just a believer that overcomes the world. You believe that Jesus now reigns in you. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. You see, the Bible says you believe to see. When you believe it, you will see it. You will see the glory of God. So whatever things that is going on, you've got to understand that you are operating by different rules, because the Bible says you have overcome the world. Not that you will overcome. See yourself as having overcome that situation first. You have overcome the world. Now act like somebody that has overcome the world. Act like a winner. Act like somebody that's above the situation and not beneath the situation. Begin today to act on those things. That's what changes everything you do. Because I realize this, a lot of times we are waiting to do something. No, just do it as if it's already done. You have overcome the world. Because greater is He that is in you. The force on the inside is greater than the forces on the outside. So if you have that, the force on the inside will push back and blast the forces on the outside. Whatever negative force that comes on your body, it will be changed because something extraordinary is happening. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. You have overcome the world. Regardless, can I tell you this? Every man made rule is subject to divine intervention. Any man made rule, whether it's the constitution of a country, your case is different. It doesn't matter what bad news you hear. I say to you today, only believe. You see, Jairus heard bad news when Jesus was going to see his daughter. She was at a point of death when he invited Jesus to come, but it seems it got worse. It seems like it got worse. And when they were approaching the house of Jairus, the Bible declares that as they came a man comes up and says, don't trouble the master. In other words, this case is beyond help. And immediately, Jesus operates by a different rule. I see my precious Pastor Dennis Abbas Imajug. Welcome on board. Jesus operated by different rules. The Bible says immediately Jesus heard those words. It says, your daughter is dead. That was what they heard. And boy, I've been feeling my spirit with some of the most amazing miracles we've seen. We were in a pastor's meeting with about 2,000 pastors. About 500 of them, we cast out devils out of over 500 of them. I don't understand how that happens. Maybe all the people came to the meetings, but it happens. And I think about this, we operate by different rules. The moment that they heard that the daughter was dead, Jesus did not say, okay, guys, I guess I came late. Let's bury this one. No, he gave them an instruction. He said immediately, the Bible declares, he said to Jairus, it says he turned to him. I have this picture in my spirit. Why Jesus operated by different rules? Why? Because our thinking, remember that the Bible declares they made some statements about Jesus. I'll explain to you what I'm talking about. Why did Jesus operate by different rules? I told you that I refuse to operate by the rules of this world. I refuse to live a lesser life. Why would I settle for a lesser life when there is a greater life already available in me, not to me, in me? Why would I just need to activate that life? Now, why did Jesus operate by different rules? Hear what they said. This is what the people declared concerning Jesus. It says this in John chapter 7, verse 14. It says, now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and he taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned? In other words, how does this man understand this? How? We want to know how. Not why, how. We want to find out how this man operates by different rules. I like that. It says, how knoweth this man letters? Why does this man operate by different rules? Having never learned, Jesus said unto them, my teaching or my doctrine is not mine, but him that sent me. And if any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine. In other words, you don't know the doctrines, you don't know the teachings of the Word of God until you do them first. Hey, are you hearing me? There is a greater life on the inside of you. This is what Jesus said. I want to read this. Pay attention to this. John chapter 7, verse 17. It says this. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine. See, pay attention to this now. If you will do the word, you will know. It does not say if you will know it, then you will do it. God says, go and heal the sick. Just go and do it, then you will know it. That's how God operates. He does not operate by you knowing first. He operates by you doing first, by you being inspired to act on it. That's why Acts chapter 1 verse 1 declares, it says, the things that Jesus began both to do and to teach, to do and to teach. How has this man this man letters? How knoweth this man letters? How can you operate by different rules? That is always the question when you come to a place and the miracles are exceptional. The miracles are mind-boggling, mind-blowing. I know people are surprised. I give you the key again. He said, as they did it. Here's Jesus coming to Jairus' house. And Jairus was just concerned about his daughter. And then, it's simple instruction. When God tells us to do the simple thing, most of us just think it's too easy. For example, a person died and I said to them, tell them to take this piece of clothing and place it on the person. They just said, oh, well, they're making funeral arrangements. And I thought, wow, it wouldn't hurt you to do what I just said. But a mama, a nice mama in Kumba in Cameroon. She came and her son died at 9 o'clock in the morning at the meeting before I came. And when I came, they told me that this young man had died. And I came about 10:45, almost 11 o'clock in the morning. But the young man had died and they'd taken him to the hospital, to the mortuary. When I came there, they had told me about him about 9 o'clock, that he had expired, he had died. But when I came there, I just told them, just wait for me. But they took his body to the hospital, put him in the mortuary. And about 3 o'clock when I was done, I forgot about him, but the mother came back. And when the mother came back, she just came straight at me, and everyone was watching in the field. As she came right to me, as I was getting ready to go to my team, something happened. The woman said to me, "Man of God, I brought my son here from the hospital, and he died, and he's in the hospital right now in the morgue. Can you do anything?" And I was wondering, what am I going to do? Immediately, I took. I said to her, "Give me your loincloth." She gave that to me, and I just wiped the sweat off my brow and off my head, and I said, "Now take this and lay it on him. Just cover him and say to him, now live." She went and did exactly what I said, laid it on him, and the young man that died at just about 9 o'clock, he was raised up at 5 o'clock that evening. It was commotion in the whole city. It was commotion in the whole city. How do you operate by those rules? What did Jesus see? What can you see? I know there's somebody on the inside of me. I have no doubts about it. I don't pray so that that one inside of me would do more. No, I pray for the spirit of revelation of that which is in me. Wow. I think about what is it that God has put in me. He has given me all things that pertain to life and to godliness. He has given me all things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says, Fernando has been 4 days to live in the hospital. I'm looking at a request online. It says, he has 4 days to live in the hospital. Yvonne, you go there and just ask him if he wants to live. The Bible says, the Bible tells us very clearly, it says in Ezekiel, it says, "Why would you die? I take no pleasure in the death of anyone who dies," God says. It says, "Change ye your mind." You change your mind. You, the one that is dying, change your mind and live ye. The moment you do that, we've seen that so many times in the hospital. The moment they change their mind from what the doctors have said and decide to live, they live and they live and they live. In fact, I have a great story from one of my friends in Goa, India. This gentleman, he was a Catholic priest, but over the years, after a while, he stopped being a Catholic priest and he became born again and he wanted to preach the gospel. And his wife also, you know, he got married, they moved to California, and they met me in California. And then they invited me to come to India because he is from India and the wife is from the United States. So they wanted to host me in India. So we came to Goa, India, and it was quite interesting. Miracles after miracles after miracles. Do you know one of the things that happened? Because he was given a couple of weeks to live. And he told me the story. He said he decided to just believe that if he has a couple of weeks to live, he's going to live life to the fullest. 18 years later, he is still very much alive. He is still very much alive. And the doctors are still scratching their head concerning his case. What am I saying? Change your mind and live. Change your mind and live. I see Mary, bless you. Hallelujah. Now, the idea is we talked about the Love Revolution Army. We are building a 100,000 member strong army just to minister love to people. If you are interested in that, I know you are. Go. I want you to write, to Love Revolution at christlove.org to be part of that. We have the t-shirts and things coming out. We want to minister love to that heals a hurting world. It's a love revolution army. So you need to come, you need to be part of it, and God is going to do something extraordinary. Now, let me get back to what I'm talking about. So this is what the Bible declares. It says, the moment that Jesus heard the words, the moment he heard the words, don't bother the master. Your daughter is dead. He heard those words. And the Bible says, immediately he heard those words, he turned to Jairus and said, don't be afraid, only believe. There is something about only believe that can turn your situation around. The first thing we want to do is we try to understand the situation. Am I right? We want to understand, why did they die? Why? No, no. God does not work from the beginning to the end. God works from the end to the beginning. He works backwards. If you, okay, I think I better stop right there. Hallelujah. 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 I want you to understand, I just gave you a big secret. Okay, I should stop. I don't know whether you want to hear this. Maybe I just told you the whole secret of how Jesus does things. That's a secret of what I do all the time. Are you ready? Are you ready? You want to hear it again? Because I just think a lot of you just missed it. See, as the drag goes on, I can't wait to see you guys. Hear this now. This is probably the most important thing you can hear concerning operation in the spirit dimension. God never starts from the beginning. He starts from the end. He starts from the end and goes to the beginning. Come on, somebody. If you understood that, you have just won yourself something, a key that unlocks every miraculous thing. God, that's the problem. I see ministers, they're trying to pray for the person to be healed. God does not operate like that. He does not come to heal you. He's already healed you, and then he walks it backwards. Okay, I think I'm done with that statement. May God give you understanding to understanding how it works. Don't look at the situation. I know a lot of you are looking at a situation. Don't look at a situation. God always speaks finality and brings it into the facts that you're facing. Truth always speaks the end result before the beginning even starts. In other words, before you needed healing, he already healed you. Before you needed a miracle, the miracle was already available for you. Whatever you need today, somebody, whatever you need today, before you had that need, God had the supply. Before you had any problem, God had the solution. Whatever you are struggling with, God has already fixed the victory ahead before you even started the problem. Are you catching on to this? This will change everything. Before, the Bible says, before you called, I had answered you. See, before you do anything, God already knew that was coming. He has something already set up in place to counteract what you'll be facing. That's why the Bible declares that all things work together. It works together for the good, for your good, because you love him and you're called according to purpose. It works together. All the negative things that you seem to be happening around you, relax. Guess what? God already figured it out. That's why he speaks the end result. He says, you have overcome. Before you even overcame, he says, you have overcome them. You have overcome them. God never speaks the beginning from the beginning. He speaks the end from the beginning, the end of the matter from the beginning. God always speaks finality. That's how I have always operated. I don't tell people what the situation is. I start from the solution. And the moment it comes out of my mouth, I know my place. My job, my place is to sign off on the things that have been holding you back. It's to sign off and say the hold has been removed. I hope you understand what I'm talking about today. God never speaks the beginning. He speaks the end from the beginning. Whatever you're facing, if it's healing, God speaks the end. He says, I am the Lord your healer. Before you ever needed healing, he says, I am your life. before you even died. He says, I am your provider before you had a need in your life. God is always operating from that dimension. He is always operating from the end and not from the beginning. That's why I operate by different rules. The world operates from the rules of the beginning. You go from here to here to here. But God starts from the impossible and walk to the possible. He goes deep and then he comes back. Jesus said to the disciples, he said to Peter, launch out into the deep. He didn't say start from the shallow end. He says launch out into the deep. If you want to operate in the dimension of God, launch out into the deep. You cannot play around the sand and see what great catch God has in the future or in the deep. If you're going to move with God, if you're going to do anything with God, you've got to be bold enough, and I dare you to launch out into the deep. Go deep. Go deeper with God, and then something begins to happen. You find yourself moving in the dimension of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The moment you start thinking like that, you begin to operate on the dimension of God. Most of us have been playing it safe. Most of us have been playing it safe. We want to put our little toes in the water and say, no, how can you walk underwater? You've got to step out underwater. How can you do great things? You've got to step up and start doing it. You will never know. You will never know the greatness of God's dreams in you until you venture into the impossible. You can write that down. You will never know the greatness of God's dreams that are locked up in you until you venture into the impossible. When you see an impossible situation or scenario, that is the moment for you now to turn on divinity. Let divinity swallow up humanity. That's when you begin to operate from that dimension. And that's why I just was waiting to share this with you today, because I know once you start doing things in a different dimension, you begin to get a different result. Hallelujah. You don't consult the people that are in the boat how to walk underwater. You talk to people walking underwater already, and they will tell you. See, when Jesus told Peter to come, he didn't tell him, okay, Peter, I'm going to give you training wheels. I'm going to give you, I see my cousin, Ayuko Saji. Doctor, how are you? Now, Jesus didn't tell Peter, okay, Peter, I'm going to start you out with floaters. I'm going to start you out with floating device just in case you don't make the water walking experience a joyful one. I'm talking about operating by different rules. I hope you catch my drift today. Hallelujah. So if you hang around me, it gets dangerous. I love that. I love when it seems dangerous. That's when God, the divinity at work in humanity, is released. Then do you know what happened? God didn't say, and Jesus didn't say to Peter, okay, Peter, you want to walk on water? Okay, I'll give you the basics. This is how this is how you're going to walk on water. First of all, dip your toe in, your big toe in, and if the water's holding, then put the rest of your feet down. That's not how God operates. Jesus said to Peter, you want to walk on water? Or Peter said, if it is you, bid me to come. Bid me come. And Jesus then said, okay, Peter, I'm going to teach you the laws of viscosity. I'm going to teach you the law of fluids. I'm going to teach you that. None of those things. He just says one word, come. Come. The moment he said come, Peter walked on come. He stepped on come and he became uncommon. He became somebody else when he stepped on the word of God. And that's why I challenge when I hear people wanting to change the word of God to fit a tragedy. No, 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 you don't do that. We challenge that tragedy and turn it to fit the word of God. That's how we operate. We operate by different rules. We operate by different rules. And that's what I'm talking about today. I hope that this is helping you. Because you begin to hear people say, oh, we are trying to press in so that we can contend for this. No, just step into it. That's how I do it. It's just step into it. You hang around me, you're going to be learning a lot of wonderful things. I hope this is helping somebody today. Because I know without a shadow of doubt, you are operating by different rules. When Jesus said to Jairus, It says, don't be afraid, only believe, only believe. The Bible says, how did this man know letters? How? How do you know this? How do you know so that you can operate by different rules? The Bible says when we speak wisdom, we don't speak wisdom like the world speaks, but we speak wisdom that is from God. It is of God. And when we start speaking, the kings and the princes of this world cannot understand it because we speak the wisdom in a mystery. What is the mystery? I've told you a bit about it. 21 reasons why we operate. The greater one lives in me. The greater one lives in you. Can you let him be the same? The only reason Jesus can be the same is because you let him be the same. And when you let him be the same, he can be the same. I hope this is helping you. That means the thing. Can I tell one of the things? I thank God with the over 20 million people that we have ministered to face to face and have been healed over the years. We have done one thing for sure. We have not allowed the situations and the circumstances around us to determine what we do. You can go back. I'm so excited going back to listen to watch some of those old videos and videos of our meetings. I get so inspired because I don't see any videos like that around the world. Tremendous miracles that happen. Crazy, crazy miracles. And I've been looking at this and getting inspired. And the Holy Spirit said the reason why I didn't tell you to go back and look at it is because I did not want you to be limited by your experiences. It's good to have those experiences. Others can benefit from it. But I want you to keep breaking barriers. Keep operating by different rules. Keep operating by different rules. I said to you, I see the prophet, Epha Emmanuel. I can't wait to see you, man of God. Power School is calling you. Hallelujah. We're going to have a great time at the Power School. Now, you have to register at psom.org. You need to register for the Power School. The numbers, we have the numbers of spaces are closing very, very, very fast. You need to register as soon as possible. By the end of this month, most of the spaces are gone. You need to register to be part of the Power School experience. Now, I'm talking about how you operate by different rules. See, when Jesus said to Peter, come to walk on the water, the first thing he never did was he didn't go back and say, guys, do you have a manual on how to walk on water? Let's go back to basics. I say to you, God never starts from the shallow end. He throws you into the deep end and then he walks his way back. That's how he works his miracles. He takes you to the deep end and tells you to do the impossible. When you take him at his word, the impossible become possible. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's how we operate. And the thing is, I can't stand just hearing words without power. As I'm speaking to you, power is coming into your bones. It's coming to your nerves. It's coming to your body and it's changing you. We are taking the message of love all over the world. The love revolution has already started. You need to be part of it. Hallelujah. You email to loverevolution@christlove.org and be part of the love revolution. We are ministering love that heals a hurting world. I see Kirk, God bless you. I'm glad you joined me today. So I'm talking about when God is operating, he operates by different rules. I do not allow the things around me to determine whether I act or not. Sometimes I do crazy things and even people around me question it. For example, God told me to get two bosses. And I told some of the people around me, I said, God said we should get two bosses. And the first thing I heard was excuses. 2 days time, I just went and we brought back two school buses back to the church. Because God, when God tells you to do things, he does not want excuses. He wants obedience. When God tells you, you will never walk in the dimension of God or walk by different rules if you are full of excuses. The same way when I talk to people about coming to Power School, they make excuses. I don't have money. But you have money to go see a doctor. You have money to go and do this. You can't make excuses and also take action. You can either take action or make excuses. You can have both. When God tells you to do things, see, Jesus said to the disciples, I'm talking about operating by different rules. Jesus said to the disciples, when the people were hungry, he says, give them something to eat. He didn't say, calculate how much it will cost for us to get the food. He never said any of those things. He just said, give them some. Okay, I should stop right here because this is crazy stuff. I'm talking about operating by different rules. Jesus does not give you a manual on how to start. He expects you to jump into the end, the deep end, and then he works his miracles. God never deals with the small stuff first. He deals with the big stuff first. I say to you, God, this is the... I see Christian hater God is on. Hallelujah. Oh, my goodness. Christian, I can't wait to see you, man. Power School is going to be rocking. No, I see Ning is there. Ning says, I can feel my baby wings are flapping. Oh, come on. It's time. I'll kick you. I'll kick off that nest and you can fly, baby. You fly. Hallelujah. Now, when I'm talking about this, when God is dealing with things, God never talks about the situation. See, man always looks at a situation. Man looks at the circumstances. Man listens to the words of others. When Jesus came to Jairus, when he heard that, don't bother the master, your child is already dead, Jesus didn't say, okay, well, I guess I came late. He says to Jairus, don't be afraid. Change the picture. Only believe. When God is about to do something, he never starts from where you are. He starts from where you are supposed to be. He starts from the future and brings it to the present. God speaks finality. And that's one of the things. This is how I operate all the time. People, can I tell you, it doesn't matter whether 10,000 people are on one side. I choose to stand on the side of the Word of God. Give me the Word of God and I can win any day. I can win over any situation, over anyone, over anything. Every demon that comes, the Word of God with you in agreement, you can move any mountains. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what I'm talking about. See, and I hear excuses. When God tells you to do something, do it. Don't make excuses. That's the secret to growing in the grace of God, obedience to the Word of God. As you obey, as you are doing the Word, then the more revelation you're going to have of the Word. You don't wait to get revelation before you act. You act and then you know that it is real. It works. Peter didn't have a revelation of walking on the water until he did. And he began to sink when he looked around. But thank God he walked back with Jesus back to the boat. Hallelujah. He walked twice. You haven't walked once. He walked twice. He walked towards Jesus. When he began to sink, Jesus lifted him. And the Bible never said Jesus dragged him. They must have walked back to the boat. I choose to believe the good news. Hallelujah. Oh, my goodness. I love this. And I see Emmanuel Remer. Emmanuel, thank you for the pictures you put up. I would like to share that on Instagram, if you're on Instagram. You put up some beautiful collage of pictures of miracles in our meetings around the globe. And great comments there. You can check it out. Thank you for putting that up. Now, I'm talking about operating by different rules. The greater one lives in me. The greater one lives in me. The Bible says you have overcome them. That is finality. It does not say you will overcome. It says you have overcome. I like that. So I go in with the mindset of a winner. I go in with a mindset of somebody that cannot lose. You're wondering why I have so much fun? That's why I have so much fun. And everyone will tell me, can I tell you this? People's opinion does not determine your success. The words of people cannot determine whether you fail or succeed. What determines what you fail and succeed is what you believe concerning the Word of God. It is working. It is mighty. It is glorious. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's what I'm talking about. Operating by different rules. Operating by different rules. The greater one dwells in me. The greater one dwells in me. The Bible says, you have overcome them. You have overcome them. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. When you're thinking of things like that, it changes everything you're doing. And that's the same thing I said to you. When God tells you to do something, don't think too much. Some of us, we are always thinking about, Lord, but I have this, I have that. When Jesus said to them, give the people something to eat, he did that to test to see how they will handle it. And what was their reaction? They came and they needed an accountant to tell them, we are going to need a year's worth of salary from a rich person to feed all the crowd. Jesus didn't ask them how much would it take to feed the crowd. He says, give them something to eat, operating by different rules. Give them something. There is something. When God is asking you for something, the first thing he would do when he says, do something, he will ask you, what do you have? Do you know what you have is the beginning point for your miracle? What you have, you're responsible for. Hallelujah. What you have, you are responsible for. So God never asked what you don't have. He says, what do you have in your hand? Because the seed in your hand determines the harvest you have in your life. Simple as it is. Jesus said to them, okay, what do you have? He says, they looked around. We have only a little boy's lunch, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes. I'm talking about operating by different rules. And what did Jesus do? He said, give it to me. You see, God always wants to start with what you have. I believe that God is speaking to some of you to make some investment in the kingdom of God. You're there thinking and calculating, oh, I have this, I have that. God knows you need those things. Do you know God can hand you what you need just by your obedience? Just by obedience, you can receive the thing you've been believing for just by obeying to do what God has said. It's as simple as it is. And I hear some people that try to make it more complicated than it is. The word of God is the word of God. That's why I don't listen to all those people that are always talking contrary to the word of God. The word of God works. Hallelujah. You are responsible for what is in your hand. There is a miracle in your house today. There is a miracle in your hand. The Bible talked about a woman that the sons were being taken over and put into a debtor's jail because her husband, the prophet, owed some money. Thank God we don't have the debtor's jail in the United States, abolished over a century and a half ago. Thank God for that, because a lot of people will be in jail. Now, hear this. They took her sons and put them in jail. And then she comes to the man of God. He says, man of God, my husband was a servant of God, a prophet. But this is a situation. He owed some money, and when he died, he couldn't pay it. They took our kids and put them in prison. That means no productivity in the house, no way of paying back the loan. You just stay there, and you stay there. And the man of God said to her, what do you have in your house? She says, I have nothing. That's a typical human reaction. I have nothing. And he says, check, what do you have? She says, I have nothing but a little oil. And the man of God says, that's a starting point for a miracle. That's my paraphrase on that. He says, God always starts from the end and works his way to the beginning. He says to her, I'm talking about operating by different rules. He says to her, now I want you to look for empty vessels. Not filled vessels, empty vessels. You get the point. That means whenever there is a need, look for it. That's the beginning of a miracle flow in your life. Hallelujah. I'm talking to somebody today. You are believing God for miracles to flow, especially in the area of finances or healing. Whatever it is, look for a need. The man of God said to her, this is how God operates by different rules. Look, you have something, but then look for empty vessels and take the little you have and pour it into the empty vessels. The moment you begin to pour it into the empty vessels, that means look for a need. Listen. One thing I do is I listen for needs. When I hear a need, when I hear a man of God speaking, remember this, when I sow into a ministry, a man of God, I'm sowing up into the anointing. When I give to the poor, I am actually giving for my health. That means for God to keep me alive. Just ask Tabitha and call doctors. She gave to the poor. When she died, she was raised back to life. You see, when you give to people that have needs, you have longevity. But if you give to the anointing, you find increase. Not just longevity, but there's increase that comes to your life. Because when you believe the prophets, you prosper. When you believe a man or woman of God, you prosper. That's the word of God. When you believe the man or woman of God, you prosper. Why? The prosperity in your life is determined by who you choose to believe and how you honor what they say. Because if you don't honor them, you cannot draw from that grace. It's a principle in the Word of God. In the Word of God. Whenever people do that, it always triggers things in the spirit. Now, what did she do? She took that little oil, poured it, and the oil that she had, the little thing she started with, kept pouring and filling every vessel. He said, go get some more. They borrowed from the neighbors, and all the pots were filled with oil. Guess what? Oil must have been like the gold of the day. Guess what happened? She traded the oil and got enough money to pay her debts and to live on. Can you imagine? It began, that is called Kingdom Business 101. Start from what you have in your hand and then invest that into the needs around you. Remember, when the man of God is saying, and he says, would like you to invest in this, there is a need. If a poor person tells you, I have not eaten, that's a need. So you have to understand that, listen for needs. And what you have begins your miracle. So you have two needs. One is a man that needs to survive. The other one is a man that needs to help more people to survive. So what do? You can give to both. That's correct. What am I saying? When you give to the one that will help teach others how to prosper, you increase your ability that comes back to you as a harvest. But when you give to the poor, you're loaning to God. When you give to the poor, it's a loan. You don't get a return on that. But if you give into the teaching or the anointing, you are tapping into increase. That is the Word of God. That is the Word of God. When you give, it shall be given unto you. When you give, it is given unto you. When you loan to God, when you give to the poor, you are loaning to God. And God will pay that loan. God will repay you on the terms you agree with him. I hope you understand what I'm talking about today. Hallelujah. So I'm telling you, how do you operate by different rules? The Bible says that Jesus, when they came to him, they were just amazed at what happened. You see, I want to make sure that you're listening with intent to learn. If you're just listening, just to say, oh, what is he going to say? You can miss what I'm trying to teach you. Because you can be offended and say, well, I don't like what he's saying right now. Listen to me. The reason why I'm teaching is because I want to see you really flourish and operate by different rules. My greatest joy is that you're healthy, you're prosperous, you are flourishing in everything you do. That when I hear this report, it brings such a great joy in my life. You see, there's some people that might feel jealous because others are successful. I am not like that. When all the ministers, all the people are successful, that's my greatest joy. Why? Because I know I don't have to do a lot of work trying to help that one. Already it's working. We can together help and make the world a better place and put the devil out of business. That's what I like. Hallelujah. I hope this is blessing you. I'm talking about operating by different rules. Whenever you operate by a different rule, God is always in the midst of it. Why am I saying this? God never asks you for a thing and then when you make an excuse, then you get it. No. When you act, you get it. Jesus said to Peter, cast your net, launch out into the deep, lay down the nets. He said, I've toiled all night. I'm the professional fisherman. But, he said, I caught nothing, but at your word, I'm going to obey halfway. You know, some of us like that. God tells you, sow a seed. The first thing we think about, oh no, Lord, you know, I have that bill. Don't you think God knows those things? God says, I know you need these things. I know you have needs of all those things. But first, make the kingdom the priority. And then your place in that kingdom, everything else you're looking for will be added to you. And that's why when I tell, listen, guys, I teach you and I said, listen, I give you an opportunity to respond to the Word of God, to make an investment into the Word of God. That is your greatest moment to say, okay, I believe what he's saying. I'm going to act on what he's saying. And I expect that what he says will come to pass. I will prosper in miracles, in finances, in everything. Without finances, your dreams cannot take flight. You need finances. You need partners that can believe in what you're doing and they can keep sponsoring it so that you can go and do the will of God. The Bible says, men shall bring to your bosom. So whenever I'm teaching like this, is to help you understand what God wants for you. God wants you to prosper and be in good health even as your soul is prospering. He wants you to prosper and be in good health, even as your soul is prospering. And again, I'm going to give you an opportunity every day. I had some people over the weekend, they were texting me and they were on a messenger. I said, man of God, we have been trying to sow because we're believing what you're saying. I'm going to help you out there. There are three ways you can do it. You can go to our website, christlove.org, and click the donate button. It gives you all the options there, how to sow your seed. The second thing is you can send maybe Western Union, just write Charles Ndifon, Providence, Rhode Island, USA. That's fine. It should be just fine. Just Providence, Rhode Island, USA. And send a message about the transaction. My staff will go ahead and take care of that. The third thing to do is also you can, maybe you want to send a check, just write to Christ Love Media or Christ Love. It will come to us, Christ Love, P.O. Box 72800, Providence, Rhode Island, 02907. It will come to us, and my staff will be able to pray over it, and then we can release the blessing upon you in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. I hope they can put that on the screen so that you can see how to do it. Three ways to do it. But I am so excited today because I know we are believing God for something big, and your partnership goes a long way to making it happen. Hallelujah. We are believing because I hope this has blessed you today. Go back and listen to it 4, 5, 10 times, 20 times. Listen to it. Let it be infused into your spirit on how to operate by different rules. How to operate by different rules. And you will you will explode in miracles everywhere you go. I don't feel sorry for the stupid devil. Hallelujah. We are challenging anything God did not say. All the religious nonsense, we are going to be wiping it out wherever country you're going to be. We are going to be in Hamburg, July the 1st, Ludenscheid, 5th to the 7th in Germany. And get ready, July 16th to 22, long, beautiful time to enjoy every day. You just marinate on the Word of God for inspiration at our Power School of Miracles. It is going to be a phenomenal time. I said to you earlier, you don't make excuses and take action. You can do one or the other. If you really want to come to Power School, you register, go to psom.org and register, and then we will be able to make sure we can secure a place for you, because we want to make sure we have all the things you need to make that week effective. We have great speakers coming. It is going to be glorious. So I want to encourage you. We are expanding on all sides, and it is your gift and your support of what we are doing that keeps blessing a lot of people around the world. And I say to you guys, there are a couple of things we're working. The 366 healing scriptures is almost all done. We're just putting final touches to them. We promise that we're going to send them to you guys. That means a scripture a day for your miracle. We're making sure we make it the best collection of healing scriptures so that you can take that like a medication every day. God's word is God's medicine. You never get an overdose. You never have an overdose, and you never have a side effect. It always works for your good. Hallelujah. I'm so excited. So I encourage you. This has been a great day. Again, this is Dr. Charles Ndifon here. I want to say I love you, and it is glorious. Write back and tell me how this has inspired you. And maybe you're taking some notes. Take some notes and send those things back to me. So I want to make sure that those of you that are watching and listening, share with others. Because the world needs to hear this. Let's put the devil out of business. Would you? Just share with others. I want to say I love you. And on Thursday, I'll be doing Q&A. I already got some good questions already coming up. So I'm just setting you up to get ready for that. On Thursday, we have a great Q&A coming out. I know Q&A is always a big deal. We have a lot of things we have done so far, but it's going to be absolutely amazing. Hallelujah. And Pastor Laurie says, cannot wait to see you at Power School. We can't wait to see you too. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So I want to encourage you. We need your support all the time so that we can get a lot of things done. You know, I mentioned to you guys, I think a couple of weeks ago, we need to have more staff on board. We need to expand, at least have 6 or 7 new people, new positions. We are expanding so quickly. We need more people that can be on our paid staff. And we can't do that by ourselves. You know, that's why we need you to be an investor in this vision, in this dream. And we know that you are making a tremendous difference all over the world. I want to say I love you. Thank you always for your support. And I pray you a blessing that won't be room enough to contain. God bless you. Again, let me know how this has blessed you. And on behalf of my team, we want to say you keep walking in love. God bless you.